from the mouth of men. Stay close.
If there's something on your mind, let's talk about
it. It's showtime.
Welcome to the Let's Talk Show. I'm your host, Pastor Shea. Stay close.
Single, safe, and free.
Balance is the adjustment between two opposing forces. But there are some spiritual bipolar people.
My church, my city, the Trinity's like my steering committee.
You will never overcome rejection until you embrace no.
Same sanctified ones that said, crucify her. She deserves to be in jail.
I always say faith will never make sense, and sense will never make faith.
Something on your mind.
Welcome to this show. I'm your host, Pastor Shea, and today we're going to be dealing with the topic from the mouth of men. I'm so honored and so privileged to be at the Redeeming the Time Bridal Retreat with Dallas Ruffin. She's given us an opportunity to take the Let's Talk Show live right here in the midst of such an awesome event. Well, we have an amazing panel of guests, men that are eagerly waiting. If you can see them tapping their foot, they're a little nervous and all. But I'm going to just take a moment to introduce our panel. All the way to my far left is Apostle Louis Leon from the Jesus Care Ministry. Welcome to the show. We have We have Mr. Adrain Bowden, who's no stranger to the Let's Talk Show. Had the opportunity of interviewing him and his wife on a show that we did with Abosh, and was an amazing show. And you serve at the Christian Family Church. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And then finally, the gentleman that has been keeping me entertained for the last 5 or 10 minutes, Mr. Thomas Hill, who's the lead advocate at the Waiting Tables Community Service Organization. Mr. Thomas, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Well, guys, let's just go ahead and get started. I want each of you to answer this question, starting with Mr. Thomas. Tell me how long have you, first of all, each of you are married. That's the other thing, it's a panel of married men. And this is an opportunity for women to ask the married men any questions they want to ask. Ooh, it's going to be juicy. It's going to be good. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Just tell me how long you've been married and how you met your wife.
Okay, well, I've been married for 17 years.
17 years?
Yes.
Nice.
Yeah, it feels like 15 minutes on one hand and a lifetime on the other.
I got you.
Don't remember life before her. I met her at a church following another woman to church.
Did I say?
But God knows what he's doing.
Yes.
And I ended up with the right woman.
What you say? So you was taking a woman, you went to church with a woman and then you saw another woman?
Something
like
that.
In the church? You realize that at songs, right?
Yeah, I was young.
I understand. I'm just messing with you. Adrain, go ahead. Tell us.
Yes, I've been married for 17 years as well.
Wow, nice. Yes. Nice.
And we actually met. I used to bag her groceries. We worked the cash and carry together, and she was the cashier. I was her bag boy. So.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Why? So you carried the groceries straight into her heart.
I got you.
Apostle, talk to us.
Hey, man, I've been married with my wife in about a week. It'll be 25 years.
And 25 years.
25 years.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, and I was a youth pastor in the church, and she was one of my youth leaders. And the pastor put us up together to be in a play, and I was a gang leader in this play, and she was my girlfriend. And that set up the spark, and that's it, 25
years. It's amazing
how
God would do things to bring us together.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Awesome. Awesome. What is the one thing you guys love, I mean absolutely love, about your wives?
Well, my wife gets me on so many levels, you know. Over the years, she's been the woman that could watch CNN with me, but also watch cartoons with me.
That's good.
And find the balance in between. She's the one who knows when to take me serious and found a place for my profound side. And she also the one that puts up with my immensely silly side, too. So she gets me, and that's a really good thing.
Awesome, awesome. Adrain?
For me, it is what I love about it is our friendship.
That's
that
good.
We have. We actually started out as friends, and we've been friends ever since then, and it's really good because we can talk about almost anything. So we have a lot of conversations that I'm sure a lot of husbands and wives don't have. So
awesome, awesome. Apostle?
I'd probably say close to that, she's my best friend. But the thing that really drew me to my wife from the beginning and still does is her passionate love for God.
Awesome.
I see the way she loves God. I've always saw that. And when I saw her, I said, cool, I want to hang out with her because I saw she was real. She loved God.
Awesome. Awesome. Wow. Awesome answers. Well, let's just get down to it. And I'm just going to come straight out the gate with one of the toughest questions that sometimes men tend to avoid. And I'm going to ask each of you to answer it really quickly for me. What, in your opinion, in your humble opinion, what is the number one reason, in your opinion, that men cheat?
Wow.
I'll answer that. I think the number one reason why men cheat is because they lose focus on who they really are.
Okay.
They don't know who they are. They don't realize who they are. Sometimes they've never been taught to be the man that God created them to be. And because of that, it's easy to get misfocused and realize they're missing out on their biggest blessing.
Awesome. Adrain?
I would have to go somewhere along those lines of a lot of husbands not being shown how to be a husband and do the things that they need to be the man of the house.
To be the man of the house. So they fall short of being that man, and so they end up cheating?
Yes.
Okay. Thomas, you want to weigh in?
Yeah, I believe that infidelity is so profound in men that men who don't have God don't really have much of a choice. All I can say is the three foundations of why I don't cheat. The foundations would be, one, love of my wife.
Okay.
But that foundation by itself could not stand. The second being the love of God. The two of them together could not even stand. But then goes the fact that I want to be part of the purpose of God.
Mm.
So between the love of wife, the love of God, and the purpose, I don't want to short circuit any of that.
Right.
And the combination of that is what walks me down my path. But a man without God, I'm not sure his capability of never cheating, because of the simple fact that when one is never satisfied, one must always look. The old saying is that a full man won't eat, and a hungry man always will.
That's good. So you're saying, so are you saying that men that may not be married would always be looking to satisfy the place of the flesh? Based on their makeup and who they are?
Well, the biology of it speaks to it. You know, a woman who can release one egg a month, only 12 a year, and if she gets pregnant, she needs to protect that for a lifetime.
Right.
A man who makes 70 million sperm every 20 minutes and can walk away at any moment has a whole different biological value system.
That's good.
So if you don't have a higher sense, if you live in your biology walks you down a certain road.
That's right.
Men are very animalistic when it comes to the sense of biology. But the reality is we are called to be more than our biology.
Right.
Now, you don't have to be totally spiritual to get this. You can be intellectual and get this. You can be community oriented and get this.
Right.
But even on those levels, you might not be one of those chronic cheaters, but you're prone to slip because you're not always in a place of protection of your own mentality. That's why I say it takes all three.
Right.
Purpose,
God has to
God,
be in it. Yes.
And
yes.
love.
Why? Because we are made up with a sinful nature, and the reality is the sinful nature can never be saved. And the sinful nature would always do what the sinful nature wants to do. Do you guys think that is it possible for married men to maintain relationship with their ex? Their exes? Mr. Go ahead, Apostle.
I say that's not a wise thing to do. That wouldn't
that's
be
good.
Wise at all. You know, when you've had past relationships, there's been intimacies that's built up, there's been soul ties that's built up, and you have to realize you've got to break that off and walk in what God has called you to walk in. To me, it's not a wise thing to maintain a relationship with anything or anyone from your past, but especially a female. You know, you got to cut that off.
What if, I'll give you guys an opportunity to answer that, but what if the relationship was never intimate? What if there was no intimacy in the relationship? Could it work?
Well, it depends, because the intimacy goes beyond sexual. It's not necessarily sexual.
True.
Intimacy can just be any type of connection where they share intimate stories, intimate emotions. I've known some couples that are going through stuff right now that the man was drawn away because he began to share his heart with another woman. You know, no, you don't do that.
Right.
It's going to draw you away. It's not a smart place to be. And again, it's just not wise.
Right, right. Wow. Adrain, let me ask you this question. Do you think a husband that has friends on Facebook. We know the social media network, Facebook, and Facebook allows us the opportunity to find not only exes, but also to reconnect with schoolmates, reconnect with people from our past. Do you think it's wise for husbands to maintain relationship with females outside of their wives?
It would really depend on that male. I know for me personally, I can do that. I have no issue with having a relationship with other females that aren't my wife.
Right.
I don't necessarily do that, but I can do. I that's something that I could accomplish without taking that relationship to somewhere where it shouldn't be.
It shouldn't be.
Right. As long as you know how to keep the boundaries where they need to be.
That's good.
Then there really shouldn't be any issues.
I like that. The boundaries, making sure it's clear. Now, how important it is it for you, for your wife to be aware of these females that you are in relationship with?
It's very critical, actually, because then that sets up the transparency and the honesty that you need in a relationship. Because then if, you know, she's on my computer and she finds my page, or she goes on my page and she sees women that she's never heard of, then she's automatically going to have questions of who are they, where did they come from, how do you know them, and so on and so forth.
Awesome. Awesome. Thomas, what about you?
Well, I have 700 plus Facebook friends, which is probably small on the pantheon of Facebook friends. But Facebook is quasi to me. It's not even, it's pen palling. It's something else.
But it has the capacity, though.
It has the capacity.
Because here's the thing. The thing that Facebook does, it all of a sudden now allows me to connect with somebody that I've been looking for years. Or watch this, the reverse. Somebody connecting with me, who's been looking for me for years, and all of a sudden, it starts off, like you said, as a pen pal. We can start inboxing and talking to one another. And to a possible point, we begin to go down this road of reminiscing and going back to what was. And so it really, a lot of people are falling because of Facebook. Go ahead, Apostle. I'm gonna come back
to you. I just want to add to that. When the scripture says older men train the younger men and older women train the younger women,
Well,
our focus should be on training what we're responsible to train.
Yes.
And a lot of times these types of relationship will distract you and really pull you away from what your call is really at. It should be, as an older man, I need to be training younger men. I sit with boys all the time and tell them, what does a man need? And the one thing that pops out of their mouths, a man, younger man, it says older men train the younger men, and then it says to be self-control.
Yes.
You know, it has to be taught.
Yes. Okay. Go ahead. Finish, Thomas. What do you want?
Oh, and as he said, it's better to be wise for me than to be strong.
That's good.
When it comes to, like I said, with Facebook, with me and Facebook, it's more of a platform of conversation.
True.
Pretty much on page, circumstances and things of that nature. I don't really use it as a personal way of
to make connections and conversation.
Like, it's, like I said, I got 700 people that I don't really know. That's just we on page
or on your Facebook page
sharing things.
Let me ask you guys this quick question, and as I segue away from the cheating question or why it is that men cheat. Would you consider, Adrain, you say you have friends, so I'll direct this question towards you. You say you have female friends that you maintain a relationship with, right? Whether Facebook, non-Facebook, it doesn't matter. Is it acceptable for you to have conversations with this female late at night? You know, what are some of the boundaries should be set in place when you should or should not be talking to this female?
You definitely should not be talking to them late at night.
Okay.
That's definitely one thing that you shouldn't be doing. And it would also be good to make sure that you let your wife or your spouse, let her be aware that you are conversating. So again, you know, like I said, something doesn't come up to where it's a surprise to her or to him. So, you know, boundaries are definitely important. Late at night conversation.
Spoken boundaries.
Yes, that's right.
Boundaries.
Right. Yes. So that way everyone knows where they stand. Because I know that's one thing that, you know, me and my wife have in our relationship, is that, you know, we know that we love each other and we're not going to let anything come between us, whether it be a female friend for me or a male friend for her.
True. As you were talking, something just came to me. What about maintaining relationship with single women? I'm a single pastor, and let's say me and you were friends, Adrain, or even Thomas or anybody on this platform. and I have a flat tire, or something goes wrong with my car, or you know, the washing machine broke down in my house, and how? Because I know females do this all the time. Is there anything wrong with me picking up the phone and saying, Adrain, my washing machine broke. I know you're handy. Why don't you come over to my house and fix it? What is anything wrong with that? Should those circumstances be avoided at all costs? Should you take your wife with you? Talk to me about that.
I personally, if I would take my wife with me, and if I'm not taking her with me, I'm definitely going to talk to her about it and see if she's okay with it. If she's not, then I'm not going to do it.
You're not going to do it. Thomas, what do you think?
Another thing I think is, it speaks to, are we being honest with ourselves? I think we cannot ever avoid brotherly love towards the sisters. I mean, how can I abdicate myself from the responsibility of being helpful, especially to a single sister under real circumstances? So the reality is, are we being honest? Are you honestly reaching out towards me as a brother? Am I honestly responding to you as a sister? Or do I have something in the back of my head that's a little questionable?
Motive, yeah.
Or do you?
So the
first question is, are you walking maturely? Or
that's
can
good.
You walk maturely
that's
and
good.
Openly and honestly? So if that's the case, one can do so. But I still think that the multitude of counsels, their safety. So it's always good to let everybody know what's going on. It's good to know my wife know, well, you know, this happened because it happens, you know.
Yeah.
This person had this problem. I need to go and deal with that, so forth and so on. I get her blessing. We rolling.
That's good.
You know, but we cannot. You see, we get so stuck into this sense that we have to live in our base nature, that every movement has to be something central or sexual, that we missed the opportunity to share the love of Christ and the love of humanity between people. So
awesome. Well, with all that note, stay close. We'll be right back.
If there's something on your mind,
Lord has given me an amazing vision. I have already made the investment. But I really don't believe the investment was just for me. I believe that I was empowered to help you take your voice and your message to the masses. If you are in Tampa Bay or the surrounding area, we have a state-of-the-art studio designed to help you get your message out. Have you ever thought about doing Bible study or even producing your own talk show? Well, this studio is equipped to make that happen for you. Contact us today. The information is on the screen.
Let's talk about it. If there's something on your mind.
Welcome back to the show. Today we're dealing with the topic from the mouth of men. What it's been an amazing conversation so far, and I'm so honored. Joining us in the hot seat today is Pastor Robert Fruster from the Kingdom Worship Center. Welcome to the show, Pastor.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yes. So, Pastor, since I was instructed to get you since you're late, so I'm going to go ahead and just drop this question on you. So give me the reason why, what causes the passion to die in marriages?
What causes the passion to die in marriages? I think for me, the only reason I would see passion actually dying is that direction changes for each.
Mm.
Because as long as they're going in the same direction, passion will be there no matter what
they're
doing.
That's good.
And sometimes that passion will die also when you don't locate where you are at in life.
My God.
You know, if you can locate where you're at in life, not where you're at, where you're supposed to be at in life. So if I, like me, if I'm 50, but I'm still trying to acquire 30.
Wow. Nice.
If I'm 50 and I'm still trying to acquire 30, then I'm going to be at the wrong place when it comes to my spouse.
Yes. Oh, wow. Good point.
Yes. So at 50, me and my spouse, we're moving into the second half of our lives. And so there's certain things that you do in the second half of your life that you don't do when you're in the first half of your life.
Good stuff.
And that's the only thing. If I'm at 50 still trying to be 30, then I'm looking for a 30 and not the 50-year-old sitting next to me.
What you say? That's good stuff. That's good stuff, Pastor. That's good stuff. Apostle, what are some of the things that you do to keep the passion boiling in your marriage? Burning, boiling over.
I'm laughing. I was listening to this.
Because he said we're entering the second half. I said you play harder in the second half than you do in the first half.
That's right.
And so to keep my passion going, all I'm thinking about is I got to play harder in the second half. I do things harder. I'm trying to be more focused. Even recently, I mean, I'm admiring my wife. I look at my wife. I realize I love her, and I just, You know, I mean, just trying to continue to rebuild and rekindle that friendship that you identified earlier, because she is number one after Jesus. Jesus first and then her. I said, you know what? You just convinced me, man. I'm going home, get my football pads out.
What you say?
You got to play harder. Kick the kids out and just play harder. Yeah.
Nice. Adrain.
One thing that I try to do is try to be intentional with everything that I do with her, whether it's going on a date night or even sending her some type of text, a random text saying I love her or how beautiful she is, and definitely admiring her from a distance. One thing I always tell her is I like being able to look at her when she's coming up from a distance, because I rarely get that chance. We're always up close together, but seeing her from a distance is something that I really like.
So. That's nice. Mr. Hill.
Wow. It's hard to follow up all that. It's, I'm in so full agreement. I've been blessed on so many levels with my wife. My wife could lose certain dynamics of her qualities and still be the woman for me, but I'm blessed that she maintains them all. And the passion is, for me, is just to allow it to be. I told her today when we were sitting at the luncheon, that she was wrong. She said, well, what did I do wrong? I said, you have now taken away my attention from the room.
You're good.
But this is my point. My point is, it's the truth.
It's
though.
Good.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So all I could do is allow myself. You know, my wife, her response to me was, that's my job. I said, I don't know about that. It's at least your gift. And that's her gift to me. She's beautiful through and through. And when I'm with her, I still allow myself to be lost in her.
That's good.
And it's a good place to be.
Wow, man. These wives, if they're in the audience, they I don't know what they... Boy, they have to step up their game later. Step it all the way. Pastor Fuster, question. Because I heard all of that now. That's good stuff. Oh, that's good stuff. But tell me. What causes men to lose their physical attraction for their wives?
I only can speak from a personal standpoint of view.
It's fine.
For 33 years, I haven't.
That's good.
Okay. And since I haven't, then I can only speak on what has made me maintain it.
That's good.
In that aspect of it. First of all, what makes me maintain not losing my passion is I don't take no one else to bed with us in my imagination.
That's good. Woo! That's good. That is good stuff.
So just these principal tools, because the word of God itself tells us is anything that goes after the flesh is death, but it's he that goes after the spirit is life.
Yes.
And so if I am allowing that to come into, first of all, I'm responsible for my side of the passion in the relationship. So I must maintain myself in that, though I really appreciate all the things she does and so forth. But to get back to the point of it is that as long as I'm not carrying any of my 50-something years old about what I was doing before I got married, who I was dating, or the mistake of, because we've been together for 30-something years, did I really do the right thing, or did I miss this here? No. There's no backtracking on this. This is what it is. I'm going to enjoy it to the end.
That's awesome. That is awesome. That is awesome. I'm going to go to the next question. I think he did that one right in. We just going to move on. We got to move on. Apostle, talk to me. When does submission become the spirit of control in a marriage?
I think submission becomes control when there's insecurities.
Okay.
Someone feels insecure. They feel they need to control the other person. And realize the scripture doesn't say just a wife submit to their husband. Everybody gets stuck on that. But it says submit ye one to another.
Yes.
So in other words, we have to understand we submit to each other because of our care and our love for each other. There's times that my wife would minister, and when I go with her and she's going to minister, I automatically I feel I got to click into her. I'm there to be her armor bearer. What do you need me to do? Do you need me to drink? You know, do you need something? Whatever you need, I'm there to serve you.
Right.
And so I don't think it's a one-way street when it comes to submission, but understanding if there's no insecurities, we submit one to each other.
That's good. But what are some of the signs, though? Because there will be men that will be watching this. that will not be maybe saved. They may not be leaders or have that exposure to God's house. And you want, I want them to have an understanding of what submission is versus the spirit of control. How can we begin to identify the divide there?
To me, the only way, if you're not saved, to understand what submission looks like is to look at Christ. You got to look at what he did for you.
Yes.
When he died on that cross and he submitted to the will of the Father and he died so that men like that can be set free. Now, we're not going to understand the concept of submission until we understand our submission to Christ and what he did to set us free. Then we can be the men that God created us to be. Awesome. So there's a protocol that needs to be followed.
Right.
Men need to learn to surrender to God, in other words, to be real men.
Awesome. Yes. Adrain, you want to touch that?
I agree exactly with that. If you are, as a man, if you're submitting to God the way you should be, then the spirit of control over your wife, it can't even come in there. So,
that's awesome. Right. Awesome. Thomas, you want to touch that?
Well, you know, there are some men who follow scripture but don't follow spirit. And they use the scripture to thumb their wives, to be controlling, to be domineering. Sometimes it's the nature of the man himself who's the alpha male, who feel he has a role in society and in culture. And sometimes it's the nature of a woman in herself who might have some esteem issues or whatever, where she is kind of mousy about her own statement of life.
Mm.
But the reality is that for someone to really have a wife that submits correctly, I think you have to be a servant leader. I believe that my wife is submissive to me, but my leadership is on her behalf. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So she gets her way because I choose her way. You know, that what she wants, that what she gets, but it's not taken from me or given to me to be able to do. It's my place as a servant leader. Mm. You know, over the summer our dog had to have surgery.
Mm-hmm.
The vet said $1,800. I come from a place where you don't spend money on animals like that.
Surely not a dog.
That's what you bury him. You know, if eating grass don't fix it.
Yeah, that's right.
But
my only thought was, my thought was that this dog that's been with us for 12 years, my wife loves.
Right.
You know, and I didn't do it because I had to do it. That was her dog. It was my privilege and honor to do it as a servant leader for my love of her.
Gotcha. Awesome. Pastor, you want to touch that?
Submission. I think they covered it very well. I have to give it to him because when he talked about Christ and he talked about Christ and he talked because I can't even see submission in a person if I'm not submitted.
That's right.
And if I'm not submitted to Christ, if I'm having issues just following Christ alone, not calling on his name and not even reading his book, but following him and what he says in that, mm-hmm. if I'm having issues with that, then there's no way that I can identify with someone else's submission. Because when I see what my struggles are to submit with Christ Jesus, I can relate to that struggle to submit to me. And in that itself, there's grace all over the place.
It's right, in order to submit. Very good, very good. Listen, what advice would you give to a husband that has been physically abused by their wife, but too embarrassed to address it? So this is a scenario where the tables are turned. It's not the male is not the aggressor, but it's the female that is the aggressor. And typically, because of the male ego and other things, male don't want to talk about the fact that, you know what, my wife literally is abusing me. My wife is fighting me. She's beating me. Whatever. What advice would you guys give on this panel to men? Because this is a real issue. It's a real issue. It's an issue that is not heard of because of the fact that males don't talk about it. What advice would you give men that is in that situation? Apostle, you
want to start? I work for an organization, and we work dealing with domestic violence.
Okay.
And I remember a couple of years ago, I did some research in Hernando County. One of the things we found out that particular reported cases was about 1,200 women reported domestic violence.
Mm.
But there were 850,000 men that also went through domestic violence, and nobody identified that. So you look at what the women go through, but don't understand men go through it as well.
Yes.
In the same way, a woman has to deal with it. You know, women, they deal with domestic violence by seeking that help, seeking that shelter, going to that safe zone. They don't have to tolerate it. Well, a man, the same thing. They can have to seek that help, seek that shelter. They don't have to tolerate it, but they need to learn to talk about it.
That's
the problem that men have. I always say the three most dangerous words that a man could ever say is "leave me alone." Men tend to react like an island, and they don't talk about what they're going through inside. The only problem with that, sooner or later, it's going to come out, but it'll come out the wrong time and the wrong way.
Wow.
They need to talk about that issue.
I like that. That is awesome. Anybody else want to touch that? Adrain, anybody?
I don't have an issue with it. Now, remember earlier I said, you know, you follow the flesh, that's death.
Yes.
So y'all don't pay attention to me right now because I'm finna follow the flesh. Amen. And then when I say that, is I'm like, the Bible says turn the other cheek. And I'll say to any man or anyone, it don't even have to be a man, no one has the right to strike you.
Right.
No one has that right, and neither do you give that right because it's your man. Because I'm the man, and I love. See, sometimes we men, we allow a lot of things to go on. Not that men are weak, but men love the woman so much. It's just like he said about his dog. This $1,800 on a dog. He'd be in the backyard, but because I love her. So I will. You will come to me and ask me to do something that I know is destructive to my home, but because, and it makes me look weak, but baby, I don't mind being weak for you. So I'll do this. And you see, I'll do this.
Jesus.
And sometimes we as men in that category, we'll back off of it because we say we don't hit women, or I love you so much, baby, don't do me that. No, baby. I love you. I love you enough not to let, I want to be here with you for a long time, so I ain't going to let you hit me.
That's good.
Just straight up. I'm not going to let you hit me. Now, I might, you want to hit, then I might even put you, this could be in tape, but I told you I'm in the flesh right now. I might even put you over my lap and spank you myself, but you ain't going to hit me.
Wow, awesome. Honest answer. That's an honest answer.
I'm not saying it's correct. I didn't say it was
correct.
Right. I didn't say that. That's what everybody should follow. But I'm just saying, if we're going to be real and we're going to talk about it up here, then let me give you the side that maybe it ain't the safe side of me, okay? But if my wife do that, I'm not going to hurt her, but I'm stronger than her. I'll grab her and put over my knee. Oh, you want to hit? Okay.
Let me show how this is done. Thomas.
Yeah. You might want to cut that, okay?
On the subject of domestic violence, woman or man, I think one of the dying misnomer is that it is such an emasculating thing to be beat on by a woman or understand that. But see, I don't think that is the truth of the world we live in today. I think it's understood by everyone. I've never seen females so violent as I was growing up. You know, you see girl fights like you used to see boy fights. My daughter grew up never having a fight. My wife grew up having one. I hear people, too many females in this range of being violent. So I don't think it's any longer this special case where men have to feel, speaking to other men, that somehow I'm being less of a man because I'm in this situation.
Right.
I think there's more understanding out there than they might know. So I think you'll be okay to speak out. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be ashamed because you're not a lesser man, because this is the world we live in, and I think there's more understanding out there than they may believe.
Understood. Adrain, you want to touch that? Are we good?
No, we're good.
Look, my wife tried to hit me. Now I'm just playing. Listen, it has been stated that money is a big marriage dissolver. Money.
Yeah.
Talk to me about what can married couples do to ensure that money don't become the divide in their house. Apostle, go ahead, start it.
I don't know. To me, I just think it's important communication.
That's good.
You know, you sit there, you discuss finances. God uses sometimes, you know, as a man, you want to be controlling or you want to control the funds. But a lot of times, even in my home, when there's a decision to need to be made, I said, babe, I need you to talk to me because God speaks to me through my wife.
That's right.
And so I'm saying that sometimes we need to be able to sit there and communicate. And then there's times that we make decisions or we're trying to make a decision and there's no peace. Then I realized that maybe this is not the right decision to make. So communication is very, very important. Let's talk about it. Mm-hmm. Let's sit down. Budgeting is very important.
That's good.
You know, hiding money from each other, I don't ever recommend that because, you know, it's one home. So you sit there, you discuss it. You can have accounts, but talk about it. Let's communicate. Let's see what we're going to do with our finances.
So there is not my money, his money, and our money. There is really the house money.
Well, I was going to go there with this.
Go ahead.
In other words, it's not her money, my money, our money is his money.
Yeah.
And he's called us to be good stewards.
Over his money.
And if we're going to honor God, we got to get control over our finances.
That's good. Talk to me. That's awesome. Awesome. Adrain, talk to me about money.
Yeah, I agree with what he said. Communication is the big thing. It's just you being able to talk about where you're at in your finances, because if one person is just handling the finances and the other one has no clue, then, you know, you can run into a situation to where you have your spouse getting mad at you because they think you maybe are handling the bills and you may be struggling with it, but you're not communicating that with them until the lights go off or until the car's repossessed or something
true.
Like that.
Good.
And then you know, then that causes strife between you and your spouse.
That's
so
true.
Communication is very key. I also agree with what he says that it's God's money, not my money or her money. It belongs to God, and as long as we're tithing and giving our 10%, then you know, God will make sure that we have enough money to do everything else that we need to do.
Increase the rise. Pastor, talk to me about money. Pastor.
Oh, money. There's a lot of things with money, because we know even in scripture it talks about how money, first of all, solves all things.
It answers all things.
So, you know, and sometimes we can get in the realm of you really don't need it, or, you know, this and that as far as religious connotation is concerned. But money answers all things. It also talks about, as they were saying here on the panel, it's God. So God is actually saying to us in the scripture, he says, if I can't trust you with earthly mammon, how can I trust you with the true riches? So that tells me, first of all, with money, he's wanting to see how I'm going to handle money. And I don't know about y'all, but as far as my household, me and my wife is lovey-dovey all the time. But if that money get funny,
tell the truth, Pastor.
that money getting funny breaks up.
It does.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I am. Okay, well, and so, but if it goes that way with you, so you have to be on top of your finances. God requires us to be good stewards of our finances. God requires us. I don't see, if I could be honest with you right now, we're going to talk about finance. And since I'm a male, I'll say this from a man's standpoint of view. I don't see a Bill Gates in a Versace suit. And what am I saying is that he makes it, but he don't use it. So when it comes to money, he would prefer to have the money in his bank than on his back.
Right.
I don't want to look like I'm rich. I want to be rich.
Right. Yes.
And that's one of our major concerns when it comes to finances and the relationship. Can I be content in all things? Can I have money in the bank and don't look like I have a dime?
Or do I have to wear it or drive
yes.
it or eat it?
Yes. Yes.
And that's the message, the false message being sent to our younger generation. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
They're looking at all this limelight and they think, well, when I leave here, this is what I'm going to go after. I'm realizing that's not life at all.
Wow. Go ahead, Thomas. Money.
Well, the scripture said that the love of money is the root of all evil, but the lack of money is the root of most conflict.
Mm-hmm. Most.
You know? So I think the only one way to get past that is, or even to deal in that when it comes to a marriage relationship, is that, first of all, the marriage must be based on a commitment that it's something deeper than that earthly place, because life goes through transitions. There are ups and downs that can follow the economy, illnesses, situations, or whatnot. Lifestyles change, not always for the larger. But just because it's not for the larger doesn't mean it's not for the better. For it's the American lie, not the American dream, that only bigger is better. But it's about having an understanding with each other, having something that's intangible. I believe as long as you have that which money cannot buy, then you can deal with what money you don't have that can buy that which could be bought by dollars.
Yes.
So it's that relationship that allows you to go through the stormy times, you know. I love going out. I love traveling the world. But I love it so much because I've always done it with her. So as long as I have her, we good.
That's awesome.
Wow. Stay close. We'll be right back.
That's awesome.
Hi, I'm Carol Darling, and my product is Carol's Spicylicious Hot Sauce, direct from Trinidad and Tobago. No preservatives, all natural fruit and vegetables.
Carol, what inspired your sauces?
I love hot sauce. I love hot sauce. And you go to the supermarket, the hot sauce you get, it's all acid. It's not tasty. So I decided, I said, God, just give me something that I can make some tasty hot sauce. And here it is, Carol's Spicylicious Hot Sauce.
Wow, so this hot sauce is made out of mango?
Mango, pineapple, strawberries, apricots, you name it, and it's made.
Carol, if individuals wanted to get a hold of you in this hot sauce, how would they get it?
You can call me at 813-464-1574, or you can visit me online at TriniSpicyHotSauce.com.
Welcome back to the show. Listen, Apostle, straight into it. Men who typically grow up in maybe traditional houses where, they will watch their parents will tell them, you know, the boys take out the trash, the boys do the heavy lifting, and the girls do the washing the dishes, dusting, cooking, cleaning the bathroom. It's typically, you know, in traditional homes, a female role. And so, but a lot of wives will say, no, we have evolved. You know, cultures have shifted. Both of us are now working. And they're now complaining that their husbands are still stuck in that traditional way of saying, not my job to cook. It's your job to cook, or it's your job to clean. How can we get men to come in agreement that we need their help cooking and cleaning?
I think that man's gonna starve. men need to step up. Bottom line, you know, it's no longer one individual's responsibility. Because the bottom line is, this is our home, and if it's our home, we need to take care of our home.
That's good. Appreciate you, Adrain. Oh Lord, you end up with this one. I'm sorry, it just landed to you. I've heard women say, in my marriage, it's not just us; it's me, my husband, and his mama.
No, we don't. I don't have that issue. And I love my mom, but one of the reasons why I love her is because she stays out of our relationship.
That's good.
And she knows that I love my wife. She knows how I feel about her, and so she stays where she needs to be, which is not in our business. So that's never been an issue with her. She loves my wife. Tadesse sees her truly as a daughter. So I definitely don't make it a point to, when we're having issues, to go and talk to my mom about it, because that just causes problems. Because she's gonna take my side more than likely anyway. So
there's
just no need in even going there.
Yeah, don't even go there. Yeah. I appreciate your honesty, but it's something that really shouldn't be practiced.
Right, no, definitely not. I don't think you should have your mom or father, you know, into your marriage issues. One thing to ask them for advice, but I don't think you should go to them every time you're having a problem to complain to them, because then that's going to change their feelings about your spouse. When you may be just feeling like that temporarily, you go and tell your parent, then, you know, that may change how they feel about them.
That's right. It can escalate into something that it really wasn't.
Definitely.
So the bottom line is, in-laws, stay out.
Stay out.
Stay out. Mr. Thomas, here's the deal. Women are saying, listen, you know, we have kids, we have the house. you know, I got to get them to football practice. We got to take them here and there. I got to keep the house. I got to cook. And I have to work. And you're working just as hard as I'm working. But to be honest, I feel like we're just roommates. We're passing each other. What can we do to avoid the roommate syndrome in marriage? I felt an anointing on that question.
You know, what's interesting is that there are truly only so many hours in a day. And so you have to prioritize. I mean, you can't You cannot put 26 hours into a 24-hour day. Something has to give, or you will be roommates. If at the end of the day, all you have for each other is 30 minutes before we kiss goodnight, that's what you're stuck with. So what you're going to have to do is find a way to wholeheartedly prioritize, or excuse me, to reprioritize.
That's good.
So you know what? Little Jimmy might not do this particular sport, or this might not happen, or that might not happen, but we will augment. The only way that that can take place is if we will value the intimacy of a relationship and make it a priority. And when priorities are moved, other things are shuffled.
I like it. So making time. Conscientious effort to make the time for you guys to be together.
Right, because it's not just a state of mind. You mentioned some real things.
Yeah.
You mentioned the fact that time had eliminated opportunity of relationship and relating.
That's right.
So with that, you have to deal with the time, not just a mentality about time.
That's true. And balance is nothing more than competing forces going against the same time.
That's exactly.
So you have to make the time.
You have to make
final question, and it comes from a studio audience member, and it goes to Pastor Fruster. He said, "Why are they giving me the question?" Yes, I love it. One of our students' audience wants to know, Pastor, and I think it's a real good question. What would you say is the worst, and I stress worst, piece of marriage advice you've been given before you got married?
What, it's not the worst piece of marriage I got. I think it should be the other way around. What was the one I didn't pay attention to?
Oh, okay.
Yes, instead of saying what was the worst, read the question again. What was the worst piece of marriage advice
you were given before you got married?
Yes. Mine is the other way around. Even as I was listening to them, it even played into, he came about it. He says, now I do need to go to my parents for wisdom. I don't need to go to them by ticky-tack. But at the same time, you can totally put them out of the picture, and all those years of wisdom they have, you don't pay attention to that either. And so you lose out on that just by saying you ain't supposed to be in my relationship. And then the other one was when we first came together, and as he was talking, the only way that me and my wife could make it, all our kids are grown now, but the only way that we could make it out of that stage was to know where we were at in life.
Oh, wow.
And that point in life was our kids. So since it was that point in our life, and now we could measure or we could define success, we define success as this is the time for our kids. Yes, I do want to do this and I do want to do that, but hey, baby, before they came, that's what we were doing, okay? And we was having a good time and we was in good relations with that. But now, but you have to be in agreement with this. That this is the part where we're at in life. So I love that, and we came through. We went through it, and then now we're in our afterlives. 50 is this to me is the most awesomest time of my life. So for that question right there, it would be the advice I did not pay attention to.
Oh, the reverse.
Yes, okay. And the advice I did not pay attention to was some of the advice that my parents was giving me as I was going into it myself. And I ain't telling, so don't even ask.
Okay. Hey, you do what I say. No, I'm just like,
But it was that wisdom that she gave me at that point in time that I did not listen to. I play it over and over. I see it every day. And it was at that point in my life where I felt like this is my marriage. This is my household. But mom, I overlooked the part that mom was speaking to me out of love, even though it was infringing. It was totally infringing. And she's supposed to be out of it. And I keep her out of it. But it wasn't the infringing part. The word you used was the wisdom of them. and I overlooked her wisdom.
Awesome. I'm just curious, anybody else got some like crazy advice before they got married on the panel that you know you shouldn't have listened to? If you can't think of it, it's okay. Because I'm actually going to switch it up by the leading of the Holy Spirit. As we wrap this up, what an amazing show. Come on, give God praise for all of our panel, amen? And what an amazing show. You guys did it extremely awesome. Here's what I want you to do as we close. I need you to look right at that camera, and I need each one of you. Oh, here comes the challenge. You're going to give one affirmation to wives, just one statement of empowerment, one word of encouragement. I want you to speak into wives right now. Look into that camera, starting with Apostle.
I just want to encourage I just want to encourage the women that are out there to know that you are God's princess. God created you with purpose, and you are awesome. Your Heavenly Father loves you. He's proud of you. Whatever you do, don't give up, and don't settle for anything less than a prince.
That's awesome. Adrain?
My advice to women is that that God, He redeems, and that He restores. So if there are any women out there who are suffering from anything like that, just know that God has your back and that He will redeem you and restore you from anything that you've walked through.
Awesome. Mr. Hill.
To my sisters, God is a keeper. Life still has its joys. There is light after darkness, if that is the state that one is in. I've been blessed with one in a billion of a woman to me, and I hope you're with somebody who finds you to be that one in a billion.
That's awesome. My God. Go ahead, Pastor.
Yes, in my closing, I would like to say to all the women out there that along the way in our society, has brought us to a point that we want one thing but react another. Here on the panel, we talked about all the help we needed around the house. We talked about the two jobs we wanted, but yet we wanted the man also. So my thing to you is that how do I do all these things and make sure that he's still a man in doing those things? And so let's not have one without the other. If I can ask him to do all those things, let's make sure I can make sure he feels like he's a man through all of those. Thank you.
Awesome. Amen. Awesome. Awesome. Amen. Awesome. I feel so empowered. Father, I thank you right now for my husband. He's on the way. Glory. Amen. 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 Wow. It's been an amazing show. Until next time, always put God first, and all else will follow. Bye now.
Thank you so much.
If there's something on
we want to thank you for watching today's show. If you'd like to request a copy of today's show, please contact us at area code 813-971-5372. We would love to hear from you. Drop us a line at letstalkshow@verizon.net or subscribe to our Facebook page and leave a comment. If you feel this show has been a blessing to you and would like to assist in keeping this show on the air, you can make your donations via PayPal or mail your checks to the address on the screen. Please tune in to next week's show. And as always, if you want to talk about it, let's talk.
If there's something on your mind.